Hello and welcome to etbfsi.com. My name is Amol Dethe and I'm in conversation with Mr. Raman Agrawal from FIDC. Mr. Agrawal, welcome to this session.
Thank you.
So obviously, gruff slews of measures the finance minister has taken, and obviously we can see the agenda is actually the growth. They have announced many projects specifically for the infrastructure. Directly, there is nothing specifically for the NBFC sector where your master is. But, you know, if I could take your perspective specifically from the AMC and ARC perspective, because, you know, the bad loan is a big, you know, worry for all the financial institutions, including NBFCs. And they're trying to set up this ARC, or you can say a national ARC, you know, where the banks can park their, you know, maybe bad loans, or, you know, AMC can take over. This different provision which the government of India has done in this particular budget. How do you view that?
See, I think it's a very bold step taken and much desired, because this legacy of the NPAs or distressed assets has been plaguing the financial sector for quite some time, and more particularly the public sector banks. We've seen, you know, a long time when a lot of public sector banks went into PCA, and then post ILFS, even NBFCs had certain issues relating to not only liquidity and even some amount of asset quality. But I think this is a right move, because for once we need to clean those balance sheets to ensure that, you know, the lending must happen. Because as long as you carry that baggage of NPAs on your balance sheets, the bank's capacity to lend gets reduced unless they are capitalized. So there is a limit to which, you know, recapitalization can also happen, more so of the PSPs, as I said. So I think for once, this step needs to be taken. However, having said that, it is very, very important to see how this new proposed, as you said, ARC and AMC, which they're calling it, how it takes shape and how it gets implemented and how soon this happens. See, because often we've seen a lot of government things get announced, big announcements, but when it comes to implementation, I think that is where now the entire focus is. As I said, the thought process is excellent. The planning is brilliant. It's need of the hour. So everything now depends on the implementation.
Right. I think that's where the key is. And let's hope that the way they crafted the budget, they will also craft the implementation strategy as well. Let's hope that. The another point, which is again a very, very important one, is the development financial institutions. You know, it looks a very ambitious plan, you know, to, you know, create a fund of almost 5 lakh crore. And the target which they have placed is, you know, 3 years. You know, how important this step is, and, you know, what kind of, you know, what you can say, strategy now they should adopt to execute it so that they will achieve their goal very soon.
See, there are two, three very important things. See, first of all, as we've seen, the entire focus of this budget, and rightly so, is on infrastructure development. And government has set itself a target of that $5 trillion economy. We're talking of, you know, spending that much in the infrastructure. And funding infrastructure has a peculiarity, because you need to fund long for 10, 20, 25 years. Whereas on the liability side, if you look at it, fundraising for that long period is not yet there in India because of the yet underdeveloped bond market. So that was the crux of the issue, as we know, the so-called asset liability mismatch issue, which cropped up in the financial sector and which has been plaguing even the banks. So I think there was always a need to create a separate institution to look into the financing on infrastructure, big ticket size, long-term funding, and so that both banks and NBFCs can play a better role, focusing more on the other aspects, even including the retail lending. So to that perspective, the idea is absolutely correct. And I think across the board, people have been demanding it. So that move is absolutely right. To your point regarding to the $5 trillion, see, what they're proposing is that the initial capital of 20,000 crores is what government is proposing. And then, of course, this new DFI, whatever name they give it, it will be under a new statute. They propose to bring a new bill in the parliament. Then it needs to borrow. So it needs to raise debt, and it will have there. We hope to see a lot of foreign investment also coming in, and a lot of entities who are interested in funding and investing. See, I've always said, you know, any foreign investor feels that much extra confident investing when you have a government stake in it. So as long as there is some amount of government skin in the game, a foreign investor, institutional investor, is always far more comfortable. So to that extent, the idea is very much plausible and workable. I think it is very much doable. And that is the need. It will help not only financing infrastructure on one side, it will also, I think, I can use the word, ease the burden of a lot of banks and even NBFCs.
All right. On that part, you know, there is one more thing, you know, again, the table is into details and we are going through, you know, details very soon. But, you know, asset monetization thing has also been mentioned by the finance minister and, you know, it's in the pipeline. You know, could you just decode us for it? Like how exactly will it work and how beneficial it will be for the sector?
See, asset monetization is something which government has been laying stress for quite some time now. We've seen some steps already taken in that direction. We saw the privatization of airports happening, government talking of, you know, even in the railways, they're talking about the railway stations being privatized. And now under this, they're talking of a lot more, in addition to the highway toll roads, even things like sports stadium, they're talking of monetizing. So I think that is something which is absolutely right. See, because, you know, actually, if you speak, as they say, government should not be in the business of doing business. That is the work of business entities, right? But whereas, as I said, as long as there is some skin in the game where government involvement is there, it gives confidence to the investors, private investors, both domestic and external, to put in their money. So I think it's correct. But I, once again, as I said, my fingers crossed is all how better and how soon this things gets implemented. I think as they've said, some paths have been spelled out. For example, coming up with some IPOs, for example, LIC, they're talking about. Yes. Then I think one of the big ticket and the historic step announced in this budget is privatization of two public sector banks other than IDBI. Now, I think this is something which has never happened in the history of Free India. We had the nationalization happening way back in the late 60s and the early 70s. And now we are talking of reverse privatizing two public sector banks and one general insurance company. So it's a huge step. It's a very, very bold step. And if they can go and execute it rightly, I think absolutely we are spot on and moving towards that $5 trillion economy mark.
So you actually gave me a big hint to my next question. And anyway, I wanted to ask you about this, you know, two PSBs, you know, getting into the privatization mode along with the LIC IPO. Obviously, LIC IPO was in the pipeline since really long and it, you know, went, or I can say, under the carpet because of the COVID-19. But what is your sense? Which are those two PSPs?
That's a $1 billion question. So I think people are drawing cues from the way stock markets are behaving. So I was just watching on one of the TV channels saying that since Bank of Baroda stocks are soaring, so maybe is Bank of Baroda one of them? I don't know. I think that's anybody's guess. We need to wait and watch. We had the CEO of, I heard the CEO of Niti Aayog, Mr. Amitabh Kant, say that, you know, a lot of work has already been done. So I think they seem to be ready with the blueprint. But obviously, things will be disclosed. I think there's no point speculating and guessing. Better to wait and watch, because I think it will not be very, very far when we'll hear which are those two banks. So I think no point speculating. Let's leave it for the government to announce it officially.
Okay. All right, sir. Just before wrapping up, let me take your final views specifically related to finance. How do you see this budget for the financial sector? I know there is nothing specifically for the NBFC sector, but automatically when the government said, you know, that they are trying to create a world fintech hub, fintechs are partnering with NBFC, which will be a good move. If they're going to do something like ARC, AMC, which will automatically, you know, help the banks because they are lending to NBFC. So overall, how do you see, you know, the budget for the banking, financial or the NBFC or overall BFSI sector?
See, overall BFI sector, as I said, it's very good. And as you rightly said, though NBFCs, let me point out, one point which they've done is to reduce the loan ticket size limit for enforcing security under SARFAESI. Actually speaking prudently, you know, this limit should not be there as it is there for banks. Because it doesn't make sense, you know, you can't say that below 20 lakhs, you cannot enforce security. On one hand, we are talking of funding of MSMEs by NBFCs. So I think this limit needs to be done away with. Having said that, overall, it's a very right step in the right direction. I am even including some of the observation. One very key observation made in the economic survey, which I would like to highlight, sure, is about this, you know, it goes to the very boldly goes to the extent of saying to ignore the international credit rating agencies when they assign those sovereign rating. Now, I think this is something which has been very close to our heart. We've been saying this, you know, in fact, I would just write to implement the same, because for NBFCs, whatever fundraising avenues are there today, credit rating is in fact a regulatory parameter. It is an eligibility criteria. Unless I have a minimum level of prescribed rating, I am not eligible to raise funds. I think that needs to be rethink about, because I'm not saying rating should not. Rating should be one of the parameters, right, but we look at some of the other financials. So I think combining the two between the economic survey and what has been said in the budget, it's a fantastic step, very bold moves taken, never heard of earlier in the history of India. And as I said, fingers crossed, we hope things get implemented and implemented soon. Then we should see certainly a revival and a healthy growth of the financial sector also, including NBFCs.
Right, Mr. Agarwal, thank you for your participation and sharing your valuable perspective. Thank you so much for talking to etbfsi.com. And let's hope, you know, that everything goes well. Whatever they have announced, you know, the same details are there and the fine prints are also there.
Yeah, and one final thing, good thing, there was no devil in the fine print, which generally is there.
Right. So great. Thank you so much, Mr. Agarwal.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Yeah.